Standards and Procedures, Chapter 110.12.1.01, and Section 2, maintaining the comprehensive plan. Local governments are responsible for maintaining their plans to accurately reflect current community conditions, and community's goals and priorities for the future. Maintenance of the plans includes plan amendments and regular updates to the plan. And then it goes on to say an annual update option, 5-year, that kind of stuff. I'd just like to suggest maybe that we put it on the agenda, that we have a more in-depth discussion of, and maybe Vanessa can help with this, as far as maybe updating our comprehensive plan, or at least revisiting it and looking at it in light of some of the current things, maybe we can tweak it or adjust it.
Yeah, I think it is. You do that periodically. Is that correct?
Well, not only do you do it,
the work.
We have a requirement to update annually our short-term work program, and that's because we collect impact fees. And it's tied in to impact fee report and our financial reporting.
If you complete impact fee, you have to do it annually.
We do annually update it, and then the BCA has changed the requirements. They actually have frankly diluted them. So our last update is based on their older requirements that were more stringent. So we would not be required to update our plan until 2017, and it would be basically a minor update requirement. But the plan we have in place today adheres to the old standards, which were more comprehensive than they are today.
I'm not criticizing our plan. I'm just saying that, you know, that this all goes to, I'm getting over 2 minutes now because all I wanted to do was
I want to put it on the agenda
so that we can have a discussion about it. But I will make one more statement about it, is that we have a comprehensive plan, and the comprehensive plan, if we don't follow it and we get taken to court, we might as well not have a comprehensive plan, because the judge will probably say, you don't follow your comprehensive plan anyway, so I'm not going to make you follow it in this instance. So that's my concern. So I would like to get our comprehensive plan so that we don't have so many of these non-supportive things from the staff, because y'all are trying to keep us on the comprehensive plan, and it eventually gets to the whole heart of the comprehensive plan may be no good at all if we don't follow.
So would you like to put this on?
I'd like to put it on the agenda to discuss it.
December agenda, that would give us a couple of months. Is it open enough to where we could put something
on? Maybe
like
Vanessa
that
can give us some pointers on it. And
it would have to be a fairly brief discussion, because again, that is right before the public hearing. So we have a maximum of 45 minutes.
I forgot about that. Perhaps we should wait and do it in January, the first of the year. Because, well, did you understand what she said? Because the December meeting is back to back.
Yeah, I understand all that.
In November we have.
But we've got people sitting in traffic out there that are, and tweaking the, you know, as long as you don't mind telling them, those folks, that we're going to postpone.
It wouldn't take effect immediately anyway.
If you put it off to, I'm just discussing this. If you put it off 2 months, then you're putting it off taking effect a few months. The sooner you tackle it, the sooner that the folks stuck in traffic out there, we might be able to affect
The Board of Commissioners, I want to do this in January, because I want to start off the first of the year talking this, and that gives us, all of us, plenty of time to research what we want to research, for Vanessa to do anything that she needs to do to come back with us, because would we have to get a committee together to look at this, like there was a steering committee before when we did the comp plan? I don't know any of all of that.
I'm talking about just tweaking one or two things.
What's
I'm not talking
process?
About making a production.
What is the process?
In order to tweak it, in order to change it, what is the process?
Ultimately, we need to be directed by our board to open up the comprehensive plan.
But once we do that, then what's the process?
We have to determine if it's a minor or major amendment. It depends on the scope of change, and that determines the process. And And that's a level of detail, I mean, I can provide, if we do discuss this in January, is the different options for change.
I think that's the direction.
But the bottom line of what I'm really getting at, and Ken, can, you're welcome to weigh in on it, is the viability of our comprehensive plan, I think, is at stake. Am I being overly dramatic?
You know, candidly, I'm not sure what changes are being proposed, but I mean, from the standpoint of good, you know, good planning, good zoning, and obviously litigation, we want to be in conformance with our comprehensive plan to the extent we can.
So but we do a lot of stuff that's where it's non-supportive, and
well,
but that doesn't mean we're not following. I mean,
you know, generally, the comprehensive plan is just that. It is a plan, and it's not the zoning. The best place to be with respect to the comprehensive plan and conformity with the plan is when we are denying a zoning based upon the comprehensive plan.
Uh-huh.
If you approve a zoning that's inconsistent with the comprehensive plan, you may get a challenge by a neighbor, but the standard there is very, very high. Where you really get a lot of meat in your comprehensive plan is when you have denied a zoning, and you denied it because what was being requested was not consistent with your comprehensive plan. That is a fairly advantageous factor.
Yeah, and then the judge, I'm just trying to take that arrow out of somebody's quiver saying you haven't followed, you know, so I'm not going to let you use that as, anyway.
But yeah.
Well, I'll make a motion to put this on the agenda in January to look at tweaking the comprehensive plan at our January work session. Is that the right wording?
It's your motion.
Well,
I'm not.
May I have a second?
Yeah, there you go.
Second.
All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? Motion passes 4-0 with Commissioner Neal being absent.
Sorry, that went 1 or 2 minutes.
That's okay.
I think I'm up next, too.
And this is a rezoning affidavit statement.
Yeah.
Oh.
It says what came off the printer. I'll make sure I get that for lunch. I think I've brought this up a time or two as far as conflict of interest. Ignorance of a conflict of interest is not an excuse if you've crossed over the line. And there are instances where this could happen if you don't know, you know, who is on a board, on a corporation board, or who the owner of the corporation is, or who the major stockholders, and that kind of thing. Is this is just an example from a planning department, actually out of state, and there are lots of other counties in the nation that do require a rezoning affidavit from corporations and other entities other than just individuals. That way it'll bring up who's in there and you can look at it and then you can make a better determination on whether you have a conflict with having some sort of relationship with one of the parties in the thing. And this is just an example of what you can do. I personally think that it's a good idea. It sort of opens up the process a little bit more, so that we'll know what we can do, and it helps protect us. It helps protect the Board of Commissioners and everybody else along the line, because it puts it out there as to what's going on. And also it would cut down on if if you did have, end up with a conflict and you voted on it, then the process could be jeopardized as far as the approval or something. You might end up having to start completely over because one person had a conflict and they didn't realize it. So this way it would just kind of open that up to protect us as well as protect the board commissioners. And as a sideline, I think it would be good for the public and openness.
Did you do any research as to whether there are any neighboring jurisdictions that use this in their zoning?
No, but like that doesn't matter to me. I'm not interested in protecting their commissioner.
I was just curious.
Yeah,
as
no,
to
that's why I said
if
I
here in Georgia, if this is used anymore.
Yeah. Tom, we've talked about it, and I mean we brought it up before. Would you like to weigh in on this a little bit, or would you rather not say anything about it?
I think our discussions have been fairly limited.
Yeah.
We talked about that it would require a code change, uh-huh. most likely. Everything I've seen from you so far to implement something like that would require a change to our unified development code.
Mm-hmm.
And
the board commissioners would have to approve
the
it.
Process
it's like something
to even it's really begin the formal part of the process would take board of commissioner action. On the planning commission, we could recommend to them and suggest that we think it's important. And we'd like them to consider it.
That's all I'm trying to do.
Start the process. They should have enough to just say, yeah, this is something we want. We want to go through the public hearing process. Public hearing at the Planning Commission, public hearing at the Board of Commissioners, then potential adoption.
So that's kind of what I've got in mind is to start the process, you know, and to start the process, first of all, you have to talk about it. So I mean, we're at the stage of just talking about it. I would like to get to a point where maybe we can look into it more, make a formal recommendation. Hopefully we would all agree that it's a good thing and recommend it to the board commissioners. From what you said, Pam, it sounds like that you'd like to have more input from, but I don't know that, I personally don't need any more input. I mean, it's pretty simple and straightforward to me.
Well, we have the county attorney here. I would like to hear his take on something like this.
We discussed this, I think, at the last training session we did, and I think we talked about the notion of a conflict of interest and what that would mean, and I think that the conclusion we reached is that a conflicted vote in a zoning action can void the actual action taken in the case that you didn't know it. I mean, you know, you go down those hypotheticals, but if you didn't know you had a conflict, could you have been influenced by the unknowable, you know? But I think the way I concluded in my presentation was, I'm not sure a reviewing court would care. I think that practically speaking, you still wouldn't have had the culpability, but to the extent your brother was on the LLC that was the applicant, you know, if you didn't know that, candidly, first of all, shame on you if you didn't know that. And secondly, I think a reviewing court would say, well, you know, you should have known it. So this wouldn't trouble me at all. I've never seen one quite this exacting before, but I just had a chance to look through it. But, you know, what this reminded me of when I first looked at it, it reminded me of a certificate of interested persons in federal court. Is what it reminded me of. Whenever you've got federal court litigation, the first thing you have to identify is basically everyone who has any potential interest in litigation. And it's for, so the district judges will know if they need to recuse or not. So that's the first
thing. There's nothing wrong with, well, I appreciate your comments.
No, there's nothing wrong at all with it. I agree with Tom that it would require a zoning change.
Are there any neighboring jurisdictions that you know of that do anything like this?
You know, I'm not aware of them. Commissioner Bowman, but I would have to look before I could say no. I would need to go look, and I have not looked.
And why is that important?
I would like to know if the process has been successful or if it has encumbered and made things more difficult than what it was before they instituted it. I'd like to see how it works. Well, everybody, I'd like to see how it works. A lot of times, it's difficult to find members of LLCs or I mean it's
that I know it's not, difficult that's it's why I
easy,
think it would be
it's not an easy
it's
thing
not
to
easy
do
for them it's
a,
not hard for the members of the LLC to provide it. It's hard for us to go look and see who's there. But as far as asking the corporate entity to just identify who's there so that we'll know, that's not hard.
What could be the negatives? I mean, we see a lot of positives out of what could be the negatives?
The zoning could get turned down unintentionally.
No, I'm saying the negatives of...
No, I'm not sure there would be much of a negative. The only thing you might want to admonish the individuals that are in the agency decision makers is to make sure they make the decision based on land use and zoning and not personalities.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But
that's the only negative.
No, and that's not...
That's the first time it was brought up. I didn't even mention that.
Right. So, I mean, but...
Would you like to make a motion to send a request like this to the Board of Commissioners for them to look at it? It has to come from them anyway.
I would like to make a motion to do that, yes.
If you think about when you do that, something we haven't done a lot in the past is something that's clearly one of our powers. Think about how much homework you want to do before you send it up there. If you send it up there just with a statement of, I think you should do this, and you put all the work on them to work out the details, maybe that'll be successful.
You're saying it's not a bad idea.
You might want to polish this thing a little more before you throw it up there, and you give them more of a, not necessarily a finished product, but at least an outline of what you're talking about and what's essential to, you're trying to resolve. What's an example that would do it? I'd suggest you give them a little more product.
Don't put
all the work on them.
Request that I be allowed to discuss this with our council and come up with a plan to forward on to the Board of Commissioners in the form of a recommendation.
Discuss with who?
Our council.
The person we're supposed to use
as an attorney.
With Mr. Terrard.
That's right.
I think ideally it would be if you want to spearhead working on it, you work on it for the next 3 weeks or whatever with Ken. We see it here. We try to email it out to all PC members 2 weeks before our next work session. Then the PC as a whole has an opportunity to say, let's send this upstairs. I like what I see.
And if you want to be in on it, maybe I can work with both parties if you don't mind. Does anybody have a problem with that?
So basically the request is that we'd have this on our next work session, decide if we want to
have a vote. Yeah. And in the meantime, we can get together and come up with something to present to the Planning Commission that hopefully...
Is that enough time?
Yeah, again, it really, from my perspective, how I would view this is this would be a text amendment, and then I would, once the board embraces the text amendment, I would put it to staff to prepare the forms. That would be my recommendation.
Oh, yeah.
The board gives direction from the policy and the ordinance, and then staff will prepare the forms to effectuate the policy. Mm-hmm. I don't want the forms approved by the board.
Right.
But the policy can be approved.
Fairly limited outline would be your task for the next couple of weeks. Not creating every form, changes, but just...
I have no problem with that.
A one or two page document that could land on their agenda upstairs, and they could say, I understand this and I'm comfortable talking about it.
I agree, the simpler the better.
So this is
not a complicated thing.
I make it a motion just so we know clearly it's going to be on our next agenda.
I make a motion.
Work session. I like that.
May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Nolan. All those in favor of the motion, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Any opposed? Motion passes 4-0 with Commissioner Neal being absent.
Thank you all. I appreciate that.
The next thing I wanted to talk about was ex parte communication. This came up at a training session that some of us attended in Athens. The instructor talked about ex parte communication and how it was not allowed under any circumstances. And the people at the table where I was questioned that because we have communication with several different entities, especially the residents when there's a rezoning. And if you said there was no ex parte communication, we would not have any communication with the residents to be able to come up with conditions or anything else. I had Vanessa look into Cherokee, Alpharetta, Roswell, and then she spoke with Nancy, who now is employed by Forsyth County, with what they do considering the ex parte. In Cherokee, the Planning Commission will neither individually or as a group meet with anyone prior to the hearing. Obviously, they receive emails that we place in the case file, but that's it. In Alpharetta, we leave it up to each individual commissioner to decide if they want to meet. Most of our members do not meet. However, there is no regulation against it. Of course, if they meet in a group, no more than three at a time would be permitted. Roswell, the answer usually comes from the city attorney in controlling the integrity of the public process. No contact should take place outside the public hearing. However, with the use of email and public open records, the process usually gets messy. Gwinnett County indicated that while applicant contact with the Planning Commission was encouraged, they did not allow the negotiation of conditions to occur late in the process so that any conditions could be analyzed by staff and also be reviewed by the public well before the public hearing. And that's all the research that has been done. The county attorney has spoken to us before about ex parte communication, and I will now let you speak again concerning it.
That's interesting. Thank you, Madam Chairman. Just a couple of questions. With respect to that list of all of the jurisdictions, with respect to ones, particularly those that prohibit it, how do they prohibit it? Is that done by way of bylaws or internal operating rules?
I do not know that. Do you know that?
Jerry received the information, so it was just okay. An informal conversation.
Then I'm going to plunge headlong into speculation and just make it up for them how they do that. I would wager that is either a cultural thing that they have set, either just they've all agreed without taking formal action, or it may be that they have actually codified it or made some sort of a rule amongst themselves. But with respect to what you do in the realm of zoning, I think I've said this out loud, and I've said it in writing, and I'll say it again. There is no rule of law that says that you cannot have ex parte. I mean, there's no rule of law that says you cannot meet with citizens, both for or against, stakeholders, both for or against a zoning application, individually. You can't meet as a quorum, and you all understand that. But as far as this rule that you are a judge and you are meeting with an opposing party in litigation, that doesn't apply. Zoning is not litigation. Zoning is legislation. And you are a vital component of the enactment of legislation. Now, to the extent that you wanted to limit yourself, you have every right to do that. If you all would like to adopt an internal rule of organization that says that no member here will meet or interact with any member of the public or any stakeholder in the zoning, and we will decide all of our issues based upon a public hearing and what goes on in this work session, you have every right to do that. And I think that I put in one of the communications where I said that, I said, that will probably make life easier for each of you. That will probably make life, now whether it makes better decision making, I can't say that, but I think it will make life easier probably for you and maybe for staff if that's the way you want to be.
Judge, to the argument of what we were hearing a minute ago, that you know, if you put this affidavit before, it makes more work for you. So well, if you're going to be consistent and say that's more work, then you to be consistent, yeah. You'd say, well, we don't want to do ex parte. But I'm not making a judgment.
Well, it's a good example. The work session on the Board of Commissioners meeting, we were discussing. I hope y'all may have seen it. If you didn't, I understand. We were talking about our variance criteria. And we were going down the notion of our variance criteria might need to be tightened up a little bit. And one of the things we kind of came upon, though, is everybody wants the variance criteria to be tightened up except when you want it to be loose, right? Because you want it when you want it. And my only point is that for every time that we're able to shut down some stakeholder and say, you can't come approach us outside the meeting, there's going to be that next zoning where you really want to meet with that person to become more educated on that issue, or maybe it's a group of citizens and you say, no, I can't meet, we've got this rule. So sort of what Tom just said, you know, wait, before we go off and start setting policy, let's think this through. On ex parte, here's the law. It's not just because I say so, I know I'm right on this. The law is zoning is legislation, okay? And there is no ex parte prohibition in the realm of litigation. Now there's perceptions, and I think we've talked about that a lot in here, the notion of if you'll only meet with one side of an equation and never the other side, well, I don't like that. I would recommend you not do that. I think that is unfair, and I think that's inequitable. If you're going to meet with one stakeholder, you meet with both sides. And we both know there are different sides of every piece of legislation.
But sometimes there's just one side.
Sometimes there are. That's true. But sometimes there's opposite sides. So let's make sure we're fair and we're equitable and we treat all people the same. That's a function of, candidly, equal protection. You know, treat similarly situated individuals the same. But if you're looking at someone's going to say that's illegal in the context of zoning, that's not accurate. Now, if you guys want to, and you know, to the extent that this teacher at this seminar was taking a strong position on that, I'm not going to begrudge that individual for doing that. And this individual, that trainer, may have their reasons for saying that, and she might have been trying to say, let's err on the side of caution, and she may have been taking that position to try and save you from yourselves and don't want you to, you know, but I'm your county attorney, and I'm telling you, you can do that. You need to make sure not to forecast your vote. You need to make sure that your time is divided so that you can meet with both sides. Obviously, you need to do nothing unethical, right? I mean, certainly we don't want to, you know, take gifts or even the B word. Obviously, we don't want to go there. But this is up to you. This decision as to how you want to coordinate or conduct yourselves in this manner. And if you say, you know, the status quo is fine, and we're providing equal access to all the stakeholders, I can live with that. If you say, you know what, we've thought about this and we would like to shut it down and only hear information in the work session or in the regular meeting at the open set at the public hearing, I can support that as well. That's where I won't go. I've now told you what's legal. I'm not going to tell you what you must do.
Well, it was interesting during the class because we asked her, how then did they have conditions put on the zoning if they wanted conditions? And she said, well, during the public hearing, we work out the conditions. And I saw a glimpse of what would happen in a regular board of commission meeting, this last board of commission meeting, over five trees in this gentleman. And it lasted 20 or 25 minutes and ended up being postponed. So I was sitting there thinking, if we had to do something like that during a meeting to come up with conditions, it would be, I think, not very good. And not the procedure would not be a very good procedure.
I was at that educational seminar and I learned a little bit from it. And I don't remember. I thought, and I may be wrong too, but I thought that the instructor said that I think over there in Athens Clark County that the planning department had the conditions already all worked out. That was what I took away.
The residents go to staff, are there worked out at the public hearing?
What now?
They go to staff. Residents go to the staff, but also they're worked out at the public hearing.
Rather than coming to us and handing us a list of the conditions they want, whether it's the applicant or the public, you know. So in other words, somebody didn't come to us and what's your take on that, Ken? Should we be accepting a list of conditions from the public or from the applicants, or should it go to the planning department, or should they be? I know they are presented generally at the department, but a lot of times they're handed to us.
I will say this. Let me just say this. Staff and me, we're going to view a zoning differently, for instance, than a district commissioner is. And without painting with too broad a brush. Staff are going to view it probably for inconsistency and integrity with the UDC, consistency and integrity with the comprehensive plan, whereas a Board of Commission member may be much more aligned with trying to address specific concerns of specific constituencies. My point simply is that if staff are driving what conditions go in there, they're going to be good conditions, but they may not pick up on some of the things that are directly the product of citizens, stakeholders affected by that zoning. And a Board of Commission member, I'm sorry, is just going to be more sensitive to that.
Well, it would be the citizens who would suffer, I think.
Well, and I'm not suggesting that a staff member couldn't take that same condition or concern and memorialize it into a condition, but I'm sorry.
You're talking about something different than what I'm thinking about. Rather than present the list to us individually, like if it's in my district and somebody comes from my district and says, these are the things I really would like to have, you know, and I thought, rather than do that, they present them at the public hearing. Now, they can do both. And that's what I'm questioning. Do we, I'm not suggesting that neither side get a chance to put it out there. I'm just suggesting, and I'm not really even suggesting, I'm just saying, what's your take on not accepting them individually and having them be broadcast in public?
What happens if like somebody Gwinnett can't be there, though?
Huh?
You mean like what Gwinnett
well,
does?
I don't
it has to be
Gwinnett,
done
so,
by, well, it's what I said. Then allow the negotiation of conditions to occur, but not late in the process because the conditions need to be analyzed by staff.
Right.
No, I'm not saying that either. I'm just saying it's all in the public. It's in open government. It's not over coffee when you're talking to a resident who's affected and they want this, you know, or you're meeting with the developer. Have them presented, Ken understands.
No, I don't think there, I know what your question is, and I don't think there is necessarily a right or wrong answer. The only thing I would say is whatever the ultimate outcome is it needs to be published, people need to be put on notice of it, and then it needs to be applied equally by all the commissioners. Right now, there is no restriction. I mean, the conditions come in, they can come in, they can be negotiated. You saw them negotiated during the meeting where the commissioners are trying to address a particularized concern.
But that was an open meeting as opposed to
that's true.
Working on them over coffee.
Now, the UDC does require that applicant requested conditions be in the public participation report. Now, as we know, those are continuing to be negotiated up until the public hearing. Mm-hmm. But the public participation report is supposed to show applicant requested conditions, and then that gives staff an opportunity to comment upon any of those conditions in terms of technical comments. Mm-hmm. Now, right now, that report is due just 1 week before this meeting, which is why we actually have postponements if we don't get that report in on time, even after they're legally advertised. So we do have a process in place in Chapter 8, but we're saying we do want to see.
So what happens if they don't get the report in?
They are automatically postponed.
Well, why don't we postpone somebody if you've got like a small thing in the report, like some conditions, but yet they want to change the whole zoning category, and we can do that in a meeting, and nothing happens. But yet if they want to change a condition, you know, and they don't do it.
Well, if they don't submit the report, we have to have some form of report. If they don't turn in the report at all, then we
do. Yeah, but what I'm saying is, I mean, we've had Res 4 got a, or Res 6 got a Res 4 right before our eyes, you know, and there's not a requirement to. I'm not criticizing, I'm just following up.
At the action of the Planning Commission, a change like that would take place, not the applicant. I don't think you've seen anywhere the applicant has come into your meeting and said, I've changed my request to Res 4. You've seen plenty of examples where they come in and say, I'm open to getting less if that's what you're going to give me. But I don't think you've seen them where they've said, I'm changing.
I remember.
I believe it has happened, Tom.
It has happened, because I remember, I remember somebody saying, we're downzoning from a 6 to a 4.
Yeah.
And I said, no, you're not.
The request has been made at the public hearing. Actually, it was.
A request, isn't that they would accept a res 4?
No, they said that we're changing.
They submitted a different site plan.
And they didn't have to submit.
To the planning commission.
Yes.
Not to us.
Yeah.
Not to our staff.
That's correct.
Yeah.
Yes, it was submitted at the public hearing.
It's all what the planning commission is accepting.
Yes, not to us.
Applicants have not changed anything with our staff.
That is correct.
I'm not criticizing anything.
That is correct.
Yeah. I'm just saying, the process is set up that if you say no, it doesn't happen.
Yeah, well, I tried to, but I was one of five.
With respect to.
The question, and I'm not trying to push one side or the other. I'm trying to get, I'm asking Ken to give us some advice.
Let me pose a hypothetical, though. Is there any merit to the notion, though, that as more and more citizens get plugged into the process, and you all know that sort of citizens, as they see the signs and they see the legal ad and more of them get involved, sometimes even after public participation, there can be these sorts of groundswells of citizen involvement, and they may bring to bear issues that if we lock out and say, this is the date by which you can submit a condition, and therefore they got involved late in the game, they may not be able to bring forward a concern that could therefore be manifested into a condition because it's too late.
Yeah, we have that situation.
I'm just offering that up as is that a viable issue, that if we allow them all the way up until the legislative action, it allows sort of latecomers to the party to still be heard.
But I'm not saying, that's not really what I'm going after. I'm going after the
You're going after
individual,
when.
Huh?
You're going after when are they presented. In
no, I'm
form?
Going after, is it between two people, the citizen and the planning, or, and the planning commissioner, or the attorney and the planning commissioner, or is it going to be in public? Is it going to be in private, or is it going to be in public?
Well,
that you discuss these conditions.
Well, it's ultimately going to be in public, because
ultimately.
They have to be presented. Uh-huh. Where they should be presented. In other words, do they have to be presented as a body in public?
Well,
or as a body
being handed you know what happened. I mean, the folks come in and say, these are conditions we want. You know, both sides do it. And I'm just trying to say, maybe.
Well, I mean, you know, was it Roswell that said, who was it that had a date certain and said, that's it? These are in, and there's no late filed conditions.
Well, I think it was Gwinnett.
Gwinnett.
It was Gwinnett.
Yeah, and then, Carrie, so what if somebody decides to change it after the hearing?
Well, I mean, if there was a proposal to the Board of Commissioners that there is a date certain by which conditions get submitted, and if there's, and you would not preclude submitting later, but if they submit later, and someone wants one later, it's automatic deferral to the next time. I mean, that would address that concern. That would at least give you all enough time to then kick those around without having heard them the night of the meeting. I understand that.
Yeah.
I mean, some of the worst, you know, negotiated conditions I've ever seen were ones that were tried to be negotiated that evening.
Yeah, it's difficult to do that on the fly.
I don't want the board to think that I'm pushing one side or the other, because I'm really not. I'm trying to discuss both sides.
I think it's a good discussion to have. I think it's an interesting discussion to have. And the more I've thought about it, I don't even, most of the time I like flip-flop. There's one side of me that does this and another side of me that wants this. But I just feel like, for me, I feel like right now the residents of the county would be the ones who may suffer the most, because I don't know that they would be heard and have their concerns negotiated in the same way that they have now.
Well, and
does that
I also
make sense?
Agree with you in terms of the time limit. If you put a time limit on it, then someone who would come in late to the game, which I've experienced this time,
mm-hmm.
would then be left out of the process, even though they're trying to be a part of it. And I don't think that that's fair.
Well, they could
you know,
always
as the,
bring
as
it
as
up
the newest member,
the
I was just recently a citizen asking questions and trying to inquire about things, and putting a limit on the citizens, I think, is hindering the process.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so maybe we should think about that. And what I'm getting at is, I'm just like you. I'm kind of, that's what I was trying to make clear. So when I get to that point, I turn to advice to the Oracle.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. And Oracle. So, is that the way you pronounce it?
Oracles.
Oracles.
My director.
Oracle, here. And maybe y'all can advise us. And there's, from what Pam said, there's probably a pretty good chance that we'll follow the advice because we're not sure what we really want.
Well, I think what you've said is both sides get equal. Is that what I heard you say?
Both sides get equal one.
But get equal hearing time.
No, they get equal opportunity.
Ex parte.
Oh, on ex parte, yeah, let me...
They don't get equal hearing.
Let me read this real quick to you. Let me read this real quick to you, because one of the speakers that you had referenced and sent you all to a hyperlink, and in that hyperlink, it was about ex parte, and the individual in that hyperlink, and I hope you all know what I'm talking about, there was a link that you all could follow that actually went to another... It makes the point that the prohibition on ex parte is more, it says this, the concern of the author is not so much with the legality of ex parte, which there is no concern. That's for your legal counsel to address. I'm addressing it. But with how the public is likely to perceive it.
Right.
And I think that is a very fair comment, and we, I think, amongst this group, and I applaud you all, first of all, for really taking these issues on. Everything that I have watched tonight on this discussion thus far, even the presentation by Mr. Amerson, has been about how to make the process, the zoning process, and the planning process better. And that's really neat to watch you all grappling with those issues, and even having sort of what I would consider these sort of very, very practical, conceptual debates about what makes for better land use decisions. That's really great. With respect to the perceptions, we have talked about that and talked about that and talked about that in here. I know you all are so sensitive to that. So just be mindful. Individuals are watching. At the bottom, at the end of the day, government has got to be fair. The process has got to be fair. If it's not perceived as fair, people will call it illegitimate, even if we otherwise think it's legal. And that's the key. And I know that's what you all want to do. My sense is that you all have a real sense of self-regulation, and if there is a perception that you do not believe it's, or you do not believe it's being fairly administered, you'll self-regulate yourself, and you will simply shut it down. That's where you'll have to tell me what to do. Right now, I have some instructions to work with Commissioner Moses on some rewrites of the affidavits and trying to get some language to the board. This may be another topic for another day. Let these percolate a little bit. Let's think about what we've talked about tonight, and if y'all have some more, want to give some additional recommendations to the Board of Commissioners, that is one of your jobs. That is one of your functions.
And that's why I feel the same way. I feel like our board has a real good sense of self-regulation. And that's why I requested to remove the change to the bylaws. Because I have confidence that this board is going to regulate itself, and we don't have to have the bylaws to make us do that, because like Ken, I think we're capable of regulating it ourselves, and I'm proud of our board. So
any more discussion about the ex parte?
Madam Chair, I am going to leave, if that is agreeable with everyone.
Thank you very much for being here. We really appreciate it.
Thank you for your kind
comment. Everything you do.
Thank you. I'm
good. Meeting minute review, Ms. Goldman.
This is just a reminder that this will be an item on every work session agenda. So what will happen is the draft minutes will go out for the previous month's public hearing. And any comments I receive or any edits that are made between that send out and this meeting will just be noted. So there are two edits. These meeting minutes were in your folder for tonight. On page 5, midway through the page, there was just clarification for the Providence rezoning. There was a typo, as you all recall, and it's just a clarification that Nolan, rather than Neil, was opposed. You flip to page 6. Under the cup, David Fairclough, it was inserted just the motion carried with 4 members in favor to open the public hearing. And that was added. So those were the only edits to the committee. And these meetings will then be considered for adoption on Tuesday.
Well, you need to give this, you don't need to give this at the public hearing.
No. What you can do is just, review the statement you generally make about adopting the minutes from this public hearing and tonight's work session. Now, if for any reason there's edits to tonight's work session after the send out, I will have to say something. So I think we just work into your, talk that you asked me if there's any edits made, and that way I can bring up. And this is just, it's a safety, and it's a way, again, whenever minutes are sent out via email, they are draft.
Thank you, Vanessa.
Thank you.
Review and discussion of applications scheduled. CP 130012, Rusty and Christine Walton. This is on Bellevue. This is my district. I know where this is. I went out there. It's an existing facility. There's a building that they have on site that they...
It's like a house, right?
Yeah, it's a house. And they want to use it as a church fellowship hall. It's zoned agriculture right now. They're getting ready to have their big Greek festival this weekend. Isn't it this weekend?
Yeah.
When I went out there, all the tents and everything, they were getting everything all ready for it. That's a fun time, too. I went to that last year. It was nice. I have not heard from any member of the public, any opposition, or any yeses. I've heard absolutely nothing from anyone, so wait for the public hearing and between now and then. See if I hear from anyone. But that's what it is. It's a...
And staff is supportive.
And staff is supportive about it, yes. It's on Bethelview Road. You all have not gone by. You need to go by so you see where it is. And that way you'll be familiar with it. On septic. The only condition of any kind that staff has is from engineering, and it's about the dedication of the right-of-way along the frontage of Bethelview. Because of the Bethelview Road widening, it refers to a Moreland Altabella and Associates design for that road work. Anybody else heard? Does anybody hear anything from anybody about it?
This really isn't, is it a, it's just adding to the cut, right? I mean, they essentially already have one as a church on A1.
Well, actually, we have dealt with, and you've seen other cups that that don't have cups because our process changed. You know, we did changes to our unified development code in which in the past cups were not necessarily required. So we have existing churches that might not have a cup approval, but when they come in to expand, then it triggers.
Okay, that makes sense.
And in your books are the project that the it's like a PowerPoint with all the transcript really of their public participation meeting. I've never really had that in there before, but I enjoyed reading it because it really let me know what was what. We'll move on to ZA3629, which came before us once before and was postponed. He requested a postponement, I believe, once before, and we
He's
voted on it.
He's probably going to postpone again. They're going to make big changes to it. He's going to probably postpone it again.
And this is on Highway 9.
Love it. depending on the nature of the change, that can kick it out.
That is probably going to happen.
Have you heard from anybody about it one way or the other?
Just from him, that he's going to make changes to the plan. Probably will get kicked out, so.
Have you talked with him about the variance that he's requesting?
He's going to do away with that.
Okay.
Anybody else have any more comments? And staff was non-supportive of this with the variance, as it was stated, yeah, because of that overlay. Okay. Next is ZA 3638, Jim Evans, and that will be postponed because the public participation report was not returned by the deadline.
Correct.
Have you spoken with them? I guess you have.
Yes, we have been in regular communication with Mr. Evans, just letting him know what he needs to submit in order to stay on track.
Okay. And the next one also, ZA 3642, Home South Communities LLC, is being postponed for the same reason. The public participation report was not returned by the deadline. Now, in the public hearing, will we need to vote on postponing those or just announce that they've been postponed?
You know, I think, you know, amending the agenda to make an announcement is fine.
Okay. All right. Next is ZA 3643, the Ryland Group.
You do have a revised staff report. And again, whenever we receive a public participation report by the deadline, that is, we do have to amend the staff report to insert any applicant requested conditions.
Okay, so that's in with this, right?
Yes, and you're having those paper clipped. Yes.
So I haven't heard directly about this specific one from a bunch of residents, but obviously the 6,000 minimum square foot lot size, it was submitted before the change to the UDC, but, you know, it's a red flag.
Have you talked with him about the hardship for decreasing the variance to 11 feet for all those houses?
I didn't see
hardship. Is there a hardship?
I don't see
a hardship.
I have not seen a hardship. I have not spoken to anyone about
it. I mean,
hardship.
That's a pretty big request.
If you look at the plan, you can come to your own conclusion about
it. Well, I mean, supposed to have a hardship, I think. And, you know, if they're individual lots on there, I can understand that. But the whole shooting match, I've just got a question about it. If you view anything. Okay.
I think my biggest concern with this is that it's in the LCI. And there's certain conditions that planning staff has in here that
relate
to the LCI.
Right. That is correct. Right. So we're supportive for those staff conditions. The LCI is our only sub-area plan that we have for Benning County. And the basis of the LCI is supporting alternative forms of transportation as well as connecting land uses.
Mm-hmm. Now, in terms of the LCI, I know that I don't know a whole lot about the LCI.
No, she does.
I did get a whole book on it.
Yes, it's a lot to digest.
It's extensive, that's for sure. And I did read about all the sidewalks and all of that. What are the ramifications if it's denied to the LCI? How does that impact the LCI going forward? And, you know, I mean, so many... In general, citizens are concerned about it's now in a commercial,
sure, I have an answer for you. And when the LCI, LCIs are funded, this is a program through the Atlanta Regional Commission.
Right.
So in order to create this plan, we receive funding, we hire consultants. We did perform a staff update, 5-year required update. We'll also have a 10-year update. But really, one of the kind of the carrots for the LCI is that you can apply for funding for actual projects. And when you do that, you have to show implementation of your plan. And that's a major part of when the ARC reviews it. Are you implementing the plan? So one ramification is you would not be eligible for project LCI funds if you are going against the plan routinely. I mean, obviously, there's going to be certain cases where it might not be feasible. For instance, we had initially looked at this, a potential connection to the Greenway, but the expense of having a pedestrian bridge was just too onerous on the applicant. So we removed that, even though that would be an implementation measure of the plan. So it would have, that would be the direct consequence. As far as the comprehensive plan, of course, it's a character area. So you're also looking at it from compliance with the comprehensive plan. And so in essence, the LCI character area depends on the implementation of the sub-areas within the LCI plan. So our analysis, we pull up those sub-areas of the LCI when anything's in the LCI to see is a specific proposal meeting the comprehensive plan. Well, ultimately, we do have to refer to the sub-area plan to determine that.
Can you tell me what kind of projects are looked to be funded by the money from the LCI?
Well, you have to apply, and they don't. The application process is not every year, so they're typically. If for us in the past, we've applied for sidewalk projects. We were denied at the time because we weren't implementing the plan, because our comprehensive plan up until this new update did not reference the LCI. And that is a pretty fundamental issue, so we have since changed that. But it depends on your jurisdiction. This plan and our 5-year update shows all the things we would want to do in the LCI, and some of that would be potentially eligible for funding, but it's transportation related. And again, for us, we thought the most bang for the buck in the past has been sidewalk projects. But it wouldn't be limited to sidewalks.
But it could also be road.
Yes, it could be, yes, just anything transportation related.
So I'm learning about these. It's essentially.
It's something to learn about.
It's a lot of information.
Has anybody heard anything from anyone about this? Any concerns from anyone? You?
Like I said, I think the biggest concern that I've heard, and specifically about this, was right before the public participation meeting, and it was that it was taking that commercial manufacturing district to the residential. It seemed odd to them, which makes sense. I did go out and look at the property, and you know, my biggest thing has been learning about the LCI and what the ramifications of not following it, or what kind of money was involved in all that.
And staff is supportive with staff conditions?
With the correct.
Correct. Anybody else have any comments?
Traffic is the biggest issue.
Traffic is the biggest issue? On Shallow?
On all of the roads that lead to McFarland, essentially.
Next is 3648 Eddie Fowler.
You also have a revised staff report for this one.
Hmm.
Yes. It's just sequential.
Next one.
Yes.
Okay. one to res four, 18.76 acres, density of 2.99. Dave's Creek Drive and Dave's Creek Lane.
That's in my district that I'm still trying to find. There it is. Okay, I've got a question for Tom. If this was to be changed from res four to res three, speaking about what we're doing, is that gonna necessitate having to start a process over, or is that something that can be done quickly?
Are you talking about the planning commission making a recommendation for res three?
Yeah.
We can do that without any kind of hiccup whatsoever in the time frame. Yeah.
Okay. Well, how about the board?
What's more complicated, and the board.
So
what's more complicated change is for the applicant to come to my office this late in the process and say, here's all the new paperwork I want to change to res three.
Oh, okay.
But if
the commission or the board,
if they make it known to you that they're open to accepting res three, and you decide following the close of the public hearing that you want to recommend res three, that's simple. And
okay.
You can do that, and then in the UDC outlines that you have the power to do that.
Yeah, that's what I thought. I just wanted to make sure that it wasn't two owners. Had a public meeting, a public participation meeting, and I'll have to comment that both sides were very civil, and it was a pleasure to see it as compared to some we've had where everybody's at each other's throats. This could be a model of how a public participation meeting should go. It pleased me. One of the major concerns is from the public that were there, I think, had to do with the quality of construction and that kind of stuff. So that to me seemed to be an overriding factor. They were concerned with the res four, but it seemed like my perception was that the quality was as important or more important. So, but nobody was really upset.
Were they concerned with the skulls as well? Overcrowding of skulls, did that come up?
I think that's just always a concern, traffic, and I mean, it pretty much goes without saying, so I can say yes and yes and yes. Maybe we should try to get control over the budget for building roads. Maybe the Planning Commission could, from some of the letters we've gotten, you would think that we have control over that, so maybe we should start trying to get control over.
Well, as we move further into it and we get to some of these others, and traffic has really become a topic of conversation, I did make a copy of the minutes from the last work session of the Board of Commission meeting to read to you all to tell you what they're doing, because it was discussed there as well, and I just will read the minutes so that you'll know.
What I saw on the site plan is some stream issues.
Mm-hmm. So,
did staff mention that in there?
It would not have been indicated on our, we just make reference that there were no additional.
It also does say that in the surround the property bordering it, there's a res three with 14,000 square foot lots at a density of 1.34 units per acre.
Mm-hmm.
It's just of interest.
Yeah, that's another.
Why are y'all not supporting?
It's a res four proposal.
Res three inches.
I
Anybody else have any comments or questions? Next is Legacy Senior Services LLC. This is on Post Road. I went to the public participation meeting for this.
You also have a revised report.
Revised report.
What was the?
Vanessa, there's a mistake in one of the documents up for the public participation letter. The address, it says it's located on Mathis Airport Park. Air Park Drive, which is clearly not. Does that affect any of our?
Where am I looking at?
In the original, in our books.
In our books, so let's look at, that was the original submission.
I did see that in the update, Mathis Air Park Drive.
Yeah, it's in two places. One page, and then there's a second page on down where it is again.
It appears that it went out. I'm looking at the public participation report, so this is in the staple packet. It notes the actual letter that went out. It's dated September 9th, and it does reference Air Park Drive.
In our book, it's
so
that one page, and then there's a second one.
No, it was
this is
sent
the first
out.
That I'm seeing the public participation report. So
September
12th. I haven't
yes,
read it.
Yeah, that is correct. You all have not seen the report, so this is a slight disadvantage for the commission to just have it the night of the work session. Now, of course, when
it's
you look at
here,
the packet, you
on
see
on the 12th.
Yeah,
there's
the 12th,
a correct. Updated. There's a located on Post Road to rezone. Yeah. So that one is correct.
And then the
September 12th
packet that
and the updated packet
arrived. The questions that they had at the public participation meeting.
And it does say that it will be held on September the 25th. So they offer time. So. Mm-hmm. I just wanted to make sure we wouldn't go through this whole process and then have
right,
to
right,
redo
no,
the
no.
process again as we have in the past.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Well, some of the questions that they asked were, about traffic and fences and why is the building so large and would this affect traffic? Does it have to be three stories? Will the residents pay property tax? What road improvements will be made? Pretty much typical questions because this came about when we all really first started getting the emails when the sign went up with that and also, others down on Mullinex, I think. It spurred a lot of that chatter. Here's the rendering that was presented at the public participation meeting. It's a very attractive building, and there is an overlay in this district for the building.
Is that the two-story?
That's the three-story.
They've revised it to a two-story.
And I did go out and take pictures of the other three-story buildings that are in the area because it was indicated that there were not any. But there are. Vickery is.
That's a four-story.
Three and four-story buildings that face Post Road. Now, the trees have grown up, so. They're not like right on the road, but this will have landscaping as well. This is the new Atlanta Fitness that's being built. So you can see how tall it is.
Are you kind of alluding And I've probably got the same opinion. What's wrong with three stories?
Well,
wouldn't it reduce the footprint of the building if it were three stories instead of two stories?
They're going to change the footprint. They're reducing the number of.
But still, what's wrong with?
There's not. I mean, okay. There's just a lot of negative
feedback. It's just perception.
Well, and a lot of some of the people at the public participation meeting have referred to it as spot zoning. I think because that terminology doesn't really say that this is spot zoning. Definition was.
We talked about that on the phone last week. It's there's no official definition of spot zoning, but typically it's associated with a zoning category that has inconsistent with all surrounding land uses.
Yeah, well, we have that with I think that a while back when going and the golf course is still in litigation, but I may be wrong, but I think that there's a 4 or 5 story building that has been put right there on Buford Dam Road, or approved on Buford Dam Road, right in the middle of residentials, and there's nothing there.
There's another one I didn't take a picture of.
I mean, Covenant Christiansville. Yeah, part of the golf course thing.
I didn't take a picture of it because I couldn't stop.
If that's not spot zoning, I don't know what is when you put a 4 or 5 story building right there in the middle of residential.
Well, I guess the thing that I started thinking about with this is a facility like this, and these people are in the business of going in and doing these facilities. They do feasibility studies. They know where these are needed, not just for people in the area, but for them to make money. And there's another one of these down the road, and one of the questions that people ask in the public participation meeting was, why do we need another one of these? There's one right down the road. Well, there's an aging population. There's a generation of people who are sandwiched in between raising their children and their parents getting older, and this would make it so that they could have their parent here and they would be close enough to be able to visit their parent, which is good for everybody. Mm-hmm. And
no impact on the school.
And I guess my fear is that, number one, I feel like there are three story, and that I think aesthetically three story fits into the area. Number two, I don't really know how many occupants that would take away from the facility, a floor, want to say 20 maybe, 20 residents maybe, I'm not sure how many. Then are you going to have another facility want to come in and locate yet another facility like this and run into the same thing?
But you're saying because it's full, but I'm not saying as many beds.
Yeah.
Ethan, do you know how many beds that reduces it?
It would knock it down from 87 units to 63.
About 20 on the floor. Those are just all of the different things that I have thought about with it. And the reason that I brought the pictures is just to say that publicly there are three-story places in this area. And aesthetically, I saw a rendering of what it would look like with two stories. It is not as attractive as the three-story rendering. It's just something to think about, and when we have the public hearing, you know, we'll hear what people have to say.
Is this your district?
About it. No, it's District 3.
Oh, so
I just go by it every day, so I'm so familiar with it.
So the thing that runs in my mind is they've reduced it to two.
Mm-hmm.
Why is that?
Because they felt there was a lot of negative feedback on three.
Was there a lot? I guess, were you at the...
I wasn't at the meeting. Was that even brought up?
Yes, it was brought up.
Was it hotly contested?
No, it wasn't hotly contested. They just wanted to know why, and, you know, said, can you do it two stories?
So the builder agreed to two stories.
So they agreed to it.
But they wouldn't have a problem going back to three, I imagine.
No, I'm sure they would love to.
Okay, so let's see what happens at the, so we have a public meeting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, Mike.
I had a question about the parking, if there was a way to change the location of the parking from being all out front in the road to the dirt. As you pass by, that's what you see. First thing is the parking.
Mm-hmm.
It could be on the sides or, you know, just as a aesthetically pleasing right there on Post Road. It might not be possible, but it was just something that I had considered. And then the variance was another question I had with the going to another variance for setback.
Do you know about the variances, Craig?
Well, that's that will impact the parking, won't it? If you cut out the variance.
So exterior setback to 40 feet, reduced to 40 feet is what they're asking for.
So could they shrink the footprint of the building, make it to three stories, keep it the 63, to not have to do the variance and change the location of the parking?
Well, I don't know. I know they have all those courtyards. You know, it talks about the courtyards inside, in the middle. Wait a minute.
Well, got some parking on the sides.
Double a little bit, yeah.
The building is large enough to provide enclosed courtyards within the interior of the building footprint. So I don't know.
And then the other thing is that on the planning comments, along with planning comments, it has the Big Creek watershed 25% impervious surface limitation. Can you give us some more guidance on that? And how is that measured? And what do we need? How do we control it?
There have been various conversations over time about how this would be implemented. And because, of course, it's not just our jurisdiction, it's other jurisdictions for the watershed as well. So what this statement is clarifying is that we're not going to require this reduction on a parcel-by-parcel basis. First of all, this, of course, is a conceptual plan. It's not the actual engineering plan that will come in during permitting. So we're not going to hold a single project to that 25% limitation when they come in. So it's not regulated in that manner. But we do look at the watershed portion, that's within
sure.
the county. And there have been, studies done with, overall impervious. And again, it's not an exact, measurement, but it's looking at it from the larger picture and not just the single picture. We're not going to be able to make that restriction on a single development to hold them to that
sure.
percentage.
Okay, so
we're looking
have a conversation
at,
with you
okay.
separately.
Sure.
It's not, there's no reason to take up a whole bunch of time.
There has been discussion about that
several. First of all, we're not regulating it on a single project, but number two, at this stage in development, we would not look at a conceptual plan and
sure.
determine impervious surface.
So your concerns were the impervious surface and the parking. Is that correct?
The parking. Well, because it seems that it would be a less impactful use of the land in terms of development. It would seem that way.
Well, the other thing that I thought of as I was looking at this and after I left the public participation meeting was the fact that this is much less impactful than a residential development would be as far as traffic on that road.
Right.
and the schools and...
And it may be that they changed the three-story to a two-story because in our books it says the proposal of a three-story building is not suitable in view of the surrounding properties. Mm-hmm. So maybe they took that as from a staff recommendation type thing. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I mean, I don't have an issue with three stories, but...
That is possible. And this was another one that staff was non-supportive of. Because the proposed institutional use is not in conformity with the...
It was that, and also based on surrounding uses that came at the time about the first story building. I mean, we're jointly at the conference, but we're also, of course, assessing it based on surrounding existing uses, and that was staff analysis. That it was not conforming with the town plan as far as future development map, that it wasn't conforming to the character.
And this is in an overlay where it has to have the four board fence in front as well as landscaping overlay.
Yes, and of course all overlays when they come in for permitting would be, you know, reviewed and required to meet those standards. With something like fence, you know, some overlays really require some adjustments to your site plan configuration. So when we see that at the concept stage, we would make comments, but we're not going to say put the fence on the rezoning plan.
Well, while we talk about this, since it's on Post Road and adjoins Mullinex, and that seems to be the talk of the traffic, I will read you all the minutes. First, let me tell you that there is a transportation summit that is scheduled for October 30th at the Lanier Tech Conference Center. So,
if all five of us go, is that a problem?
As long as we don't sit together,
the commissioners are all
going. I don't know. It seems like, or should we appoint two people to go?
No point. I'll update you if I think there's any concerns. If we think we need to advertise it, we'll advertise it.
Do we need to register for that ourselves, or is that in the county? How do we do that?
Sure. We have to register.
You have, I think there is a $15 fee for that. Mm-hmm. And we have that training money we made available to everyone. So if it's something you want us to sign you up for,
wondered if you were, like, going to let them know we were all coming if we were all going, or we needed to do that individually.
If you all want to attend, let us know just so we can make sure from a notice standpoint we're covered.
I'm going, so.
Okay. It sounds like we better make sure we're covered.
I'll probably be there, but I won't if I don't defer.
No, I had to say just go. Let's make sure we do the proper notice if required rather than not sending you someplace you want to be at.
Can you repeat the date?
October 30th. I don't have the time. It's lunch.
11:30.
It's a lunch, isn't it?
It's 11. I'm pretty sure.
And it is at the conference center. Is that correct? At Lanier Tech. That's what I thought. Okay. The minutes say, due to the transportation issues the county is experiencing, the question was raised regarding options for how to fast forward some of the transportation projects that are in SPLOST 7. The first priority under SPLOST 7 is to pay off the jail and courthouse, which will defer some of the transportation projects for possibly several years. One option is to use the Public Facilities Authority as a means to fast forward some of these transportation projects. Due to the way our Public Facilities Authority is set up, it cannot issue revenue bond debt to pay off road projects. It could be used for other non-transportation projects, which would then free up SPLOST income for transportation projects. Another option is to issue new general bond debt. This would have to be done by way of a referendum and approved by the voters. There are funds in reserves. We may be able to jumpstart some of the transportation projects using reserves and then pay back the reserves with SPLOST 7 proceeds once they become available. This option would depend on the number of projects. There was discussion regarding the following projects: Union Hill Road, Mullinex Road, McFarland to State Road 9, Old Atlanta Road Phase 2, Sharon to Nichols, and Old Atlanta Road Phase 3, St. Marlowe to McGinnis Ferry. This item will be discussed at the work session of October 22nd, 2013. The finance director is to provide information on funds that are required and that are available, concentrating on the three projects listed above. So the Board of Commissioners is looking into how to accommodate some of these road projects with financing. So they're trying to find some money to do some things. So I wanted to make you all aware of that so that you would know. And then when people question you, you can tell them to go to the work session of the Board of Commissioners from October the 8th, 2013.
And I guess the other big story here is that people who get involved, or residents who get involved with the process, sometimes get hurt. Did the press hear that? I'm always trying to get public involvement, and this is a perfect example of how sometimes it pays off. It's a good thing, I guess. Whether you want the roads or live in the 4th District, whatever, there's a...
So next on the agenda is ZA 3652.
You also have a revised report,
which is on Mullinex Road. Commissioner Nolan, have you heard anything about this?
Well, of course, a lot of people are upset about the Res 4 traffic issue.
You will notice that the minimum lot size requested is 6,000, but yet it was submitted after the new UDC.
So it should be 8?
So it should be 8.
And also the push the hardship to reduce the variance for 96 lots, or should that just be for just some of them?
No, I think it should be for some of them.
There's a, next to it, a res for 9,000 square foot lots at a 2.1 units per acre, and across the street an orchard product. 3349 is an orchard product. It is Res 6, but it's an orchard product. And I'm going to make the argument for our new zoning category of senior living, age-restricted something, because when you go in to ZA 3349, you have to go through all the other paperwork to find out that it's orchard restricted.
And was there about 375 pages?
Slew of stuff.
Yeah. We sound like whiners tonight, don't we? I don't mean
it
to sound
makes
that way.
It just makes it very difficult to know what is around it, and the citizens' argument for seeing a Res 6 on the GIS map in the zoning on e-status, it can be detrimental, because I think unless you dig, you really have to do your homework to know that. It was zoned in 2007.
So the lot size doesn't...
I'm going to check on that one. One of the first things I'm thinking is our old process, you had two submittals. I want to make sure the date we're seeing that is after that UDC change date isn't just the second part of the old process. And that might be the case, but Nessa can check with her staff tomorrow, and then we'll shoot out an email quick, because that'll be something important. I want you to know that as quickly as we can.
Okay. You know, the other thing, I was thinking about this today when I went out and took those pictures. A lot of the traffic, well, I won't say a lot, some of the traffic also is not people who live up and down Post Road. People come from Cherokee County down 20, turn on Post Road, go on Mullinex to get on 400. People from Cherokee County are using it. People from Big Canoe and Ball Ground are coming down and using it to get on, you know, they get on 20 and then they get on Post to go to 400.
That's a good point.
So there's... That's okay.
Looking at these dates, the dates on this application where they signed it is 7/10/79.
Yeah, this is, this will show you the deadline date, and I should explain, we have to submit deadline dates because Yaburn e-status is controlled by
either way,
dates and so forth.
It's 8,000 now is all I'm saying.
What were you saying, Pam?
About people from other communities who use that as a cut through to get to 400. So a lot of the, I said it again, a lot, and I don't really mean a lot, some of the traffic is generated like it is everywhere from other people who don't live in this community. So it's not just the development that's happening here that's causing the increase in traffic. People have found this as a cut through.
The bypass, that's still going off of 20 out from Canton Road, bypassing the city. I don't know how, it just, that
thought came
to mind.
Northern Arc?
Is that what we call, whatever the label is on
it? Yeah, it seems like lately that it's transitioned to more of a 20 realignment, 20 widening.
Yeah, right, so that's like that wasn't having an effect with taking care of some of these people cutting through. I'm not sure where it comes out.
I don't know if it would get them on to 400.
That would get them to 400, like over 19.
Yeah, I don't know.
Atlanta Road.
They've changed that thing so many times, I don't know where it is proposed to go the last time they changed it.
Okay.
But I think the latest talk is widening 20, but
oh, really?
How many years away is that with the DOT? Many, I would venture to guess.
Just like Post.
Mm-hmm. Many years, I would think.
Kent, just as a quick thing, thinking about you reading the minutes from the Board of Commissioners,
mm-hmm.
would it be appropriate for us to pass a motion or something like an attaboy? In other words, us chime in and say, we approve of y'all discussing this and looking into it with possible, in other words, give them some support.
I think they know we give them support.
Well, that's what,
they've got
know,
the same emails
would,
we have.
Yeah, but I think it would be nice if, I'll make a motion that we pass on to the Board of Commissioners a recommendation that we approve of their handling of the traffic considerations in the southern part of the county. Or something to that effect. Tom could dress it up. We're trying to be nice to, you know, and we might. It never hurts to say thank you.
Yes.
So probably individually write them notes saying thank you, you're doing a great job.
Tom could do a better job than me.
I think you're going to have a better chance of getting a second if you say exactly what your motion is.
I know.
They're not going to be able to vote on it if they don't see it.
Okay. Motion that we approve. I don't have the stuff in front of me, but make a motion that we. First of all, is anybody interested in that?
I think we should individually say thank you.
Okay.
And, you know.
This is going to be taking up any more time.
For Vanessa's sake, you want to officially withdraw that motion?
Yes. Withdrawn. That's fine.
It was a very nice thing to think about.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
Maybe we should tell each of our commissioners that appointed us that they should listen. They should request the copy of the audio from this so that they can hear it. I'm sure that they would just enjoy that tremendously. Anything else about the ZA 3652? No?
Staff is non-supportive.
Staff is non-supportive because it's res 4, correct? Mm-hmm. A request for res 4. And it. Okay, we'll move on to 3653, which is Howard Road, I believe.
Yes.
And it is a request for res 3, 80.97 acres for 109 lots with a density of 1.35.
Staff is supportive.
Staff is supportive. There are no variances that are requested on this.
You should have a revised staff report for the last one.
There are not variances on the revised staff report, are there?
No.
I have heard about this.
I have not heard from any citizens about this.
You looked like you had some, you were going through some stuff.
Nah.
There are a couple of issues with the streams that are on here and the floodplain and the fact that there's some kind of beavers.
Yeah, this is the beaver property.
And there's a whole bunch of stuff going on about this. I have a couple of questions logistics-wise about why there, it doesn't state that it's that it's res 2 conservation. Does that make a difference? Does it matter? I'm not sure that I know. I'm just inquiring about it.
In our paperwork and our book, staff doesn't right.
Say well, it just anything. Doesn't. I just don't know what. It doesn't say anything about it. It doesn't reference it in the application. It doesn't reference it in the staff report.
Is that the existing zoning?
That's the existing zoning, res 2 conservation.
Yeah, and I saw it somewhere. I just don't know where
well,
I saw it when I was
map.
Reading
it's
it.
On the
oh, I see it. It's on the letter. It's on the letter from the Forsyth County Department of Water and Sewer.
And it's also on the GIS map that shows the old zoning number, not the one that looks like this. I don't know how else to describe it, but the one that has the actual
aerial
mm-hmm. photos on it. Mm-hmm. It says, well, I'm assuming that's what it means. ONS in
yeah.
parentheses means
that would mean conservation.
It's an overlay. It's not a zoning designation.
Okay.
So the zoning district.
That's why I'm asking about.
So it is an overlay that GIS recognizes.
But with the current zoning, they have to follow that. Conservation overlay, is that correct?
Let us check. Usually when that comes up, it's simply a tax status issue. But,
okay.
I
thought it was in relation to how the
conservation subdivision.
Conservation subdivision.
Yeah, we have Chapter 19 of your zoning ordinance is conservation subdivisions, and we haven't seen those in a while. They're kind of falling out of favor. Usually, and I'll need to research it, but usually when it shows up on the zoning map like this, it's not related to Chapter 19 conservation subdivision. It's related to a
agricultural
exemption.
They've got a break on their taxes.
Check on that.
Okay.
And we'll try to email something out quick for you as you're preparing for next week's meeting.
So the current zoning of 3110 has I think 207 lots at 1.5 units per acre on 149 acres. And this particular zoning would be 109 lots on 80.97 acres at 1.35 units per acre. So I guess the question is kind of raised as it's, the density is less at 1.35, but the lot size is smaller because they're going up to the res 3 versus the res 2.
The same amount of property is not in it as
no,
was.
The same amount of property is not. You see where it's shaded,
mm-hmm.
and then there's the other little
mm-hmm.
portion that still says res 2 there.
Mm-hmm.
That's the portion that's not included, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
Also, that meeting, a couple of residents brought up the point that the developers are going to do everybody a favor and bring the stream or the whatever, the water back to within what it used to be by tearing down the beaver dams and relocating or getting rid of the beavers.
Relocating.
It's true. That's what I'm told.
Yeah, I know. That's what I said.
So they're gonna, I mean, that's should we commend them for restoring it back to the natural state, or the beavers part of the natural state? That's my question.
Say, I talked about that quick with the with our engineering department, or typically a resource in the county for stream buffers and water issues, and their concern is that the work we've done typically by hand or something for beaver dam removal. You know, you're not gonna drive a tractor through the stream buffer to take out the beaver dam. But then if it's done by hand, they're typically not gonna have a problem with removing a beaver dam.
Beavers have a problem.
Beavers might.
They do a lot of damage when they get into areas though. There was that area down on in Fulton County on Hopeful, I think. That's like it's not wetlands, it's swampy, but a lot of it is because of the damage that the beavers have done by stopping it up, which is what they do, right? Build dams.
Yeah, so my question, is that natural or is that unnatural for a beaver to build a dam and block water?
I don't know how to answer that question.
I don't know how to answer it either.
Probably two sides of the argument.
I'm sure the beavers have an opinion.
And of course, water is an impervious surface.
Yes,
also.
It is. You're right.
So.
Not for some pool.
It's my understanding that Lake Lanier is impervious surface.
Impervious?
Yeah. It's impervious.
It's going to be case by case, maybe, I'd say.
It's the law. Mm-hmm.
Surrounding, we have that
there's
density of 1.5 with 9,000 square foot lots. There's an R2R with a minimum lot size of 25,000 square feet and a Res 3 with a minimum lot size of 12,000 square feet. 0.96 units per acre. So.
But there's nothing in the zoning laws about beavers.
No,
RUDC does not address
beavers.
The Department of Natural Resources does have a guideline on it. It's something they showed me in engineering, beaver management and control in Georgia.
Oh, okay.
So it is a document that's generally geared to the fact that the state's acknowledging these are going to be removed from our properties.
Oh, okay.
Do they have steps that have to be taken to do this, that people have to follow, regulations regarding it?
I will try to study up on that between
I mean, I'm just thinking they have regulations about so many things, it wouldn't surprise me at all if there's not pages of documents.
I mean, one easy way to do would be to have open season on beavers like they do on geese. I mean, they do that on the lake.
Yeah.
You know, from time to time, you can shoot geese, you know.
I looked at it quick yesterday and it looked more like guidelines than rules. But
between myself and Bill Powell, who represents the engineering department, we'll be ready to answer some questions.
I'm sorry, Bill's not here. I would like to have been questioning him.
Well, we had to discuss bees at one time.
Yeah.
Bees or mammals, I think.
But does anybody else have any comments or concerns about
beavers?
Yeah. 3653 on Howard Road. This is like,
well, there are some people with some serious concerns.
Yes,
no, that's what I
said.
I'm talking about the beavers, but
yeah,
there are residents around there that I've heard.
We'll be following up.
So no one else has anything? I make a motion to adjourn the October 15th, 2013 Planning Commission work session. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Iglesias. All those in favor of the motion, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes to adjourn at 9:15, 4-0 with Commissioner Neal being absent.
I'm exhausted.
And gather up all my glasses.